Code, okay. Yeah, I was told to record, I forgot. All right, yeah, so capable champions, who the change agents are, reward effective change champions, train them, and then we have what we call cross-functional teams. So these are not just people from one area or one unit, but you can put together people from different units. Like I said, this we've already talked about this in the Cortez Guiding Coalition. So, and there's something called the influencer matrix. I already uploaded this one earlier on. You know, there's any change initiative you are bringing up, there are, you know, categories of people. You know, there are some who are important to the success of the change. You know, you really need them, you know. And there are some who have to support, you know, the level of support of the initiative. So if they don't support, or if they don't offer a high level of support, you're not likely to succeed, you know. And then there are others who are important. So if we can take an example, maybe like, maybe we just talked about implementing a transaction processing system, for example. Maybe you are running a warehouse where, you know, they are, you know, receiving and then dispatching goods and so on and so on. And then you want to introduce a technology. So you now look at those who are, you know, critical to the success of the change that you are introducing. In fact, the Foxmeyer drug one that we looked at the last time, it simply failed because they didn't take into account the workers on the ground at the warehouse who were supposed to be inputting information and other things. They simply introduced the technology without involving them. And they are the ones, so they more or less sabotage the whole system. You see, so they are very important, they are people who are very important to the success of the initiative, you know. And then you also need their support. You know, so they are in the categories of change agents. So people who are of high importance and high levels of support, they are the ones who are the change agents. So introducing something, a warehouse or maybe a system like that, you need to look at who your workers are, what are they doing, and then you can categorize them. There are some people, well, they are important to the success of the initiative, you know, but you know, their level of support doesn't necessarily have to be that high, you know. So maybe you can look at the people who are going to offer the install and then maybe run the software and other things. What's happening? They're really critical to the success. But once it's running, you don't need them to on a day-to-day basis. You know, so in most cases, you can categorize your employees. So the major skeptics are those who offer low support, but their participation is critical. So you need them. Their participation is very critical, but they offer low support. So in this case, we call them skeptics, major skeptics. Then we have minor skeptics. They are low in support and low in critical to success. These ones, and so there are strategies here. So if you identify and categorize these employees this way, there are some recommended strategies that you have to use to address or to try to bring them on board. See, so depending on which category they fall in, there are some strategies too. Of course, those who are already change agents, they are enthusiastic about the change, they are supporting, and they are also critical to its success. So you just continue to motivate them, you know, and maintain that support. But the others, you need to find ways of managing them. Now, some of them, the minor skeptics, are the ones you can do away with easily. I mean, once you are, well, they are not playing a very good, yeah.
Where do you put TOT, the training of trainers?
Uh-huh.
I mean, in this at this level. Oh,
training of trainers. Uh-huh. So the trainers are people who are now going to go out to do the training. No, it's a train of trainers.
Okay.
You are training people to now go out and do the training. So they are really very critical to the change initiative. They are very critical. But they can fall within these two. They can either be skeptics or they can be change agents. Yeah.
All right.
Because, so if you have people like that, see, you are training somebody to go and train the people. But if that person doesn't buy into your change agenda, you know, how is he going to carry out the training effectively? You might even sabotage the whole thing. Yes. So that's the whole idea here. So look at them. So call an influencer matrix. How do we influence these employees to the whole, the ideal is to have everybody as a change agent. That one, then you are fine. There's no problem. But we have employees in all these categories too. You know, there are some you need them very critically, you know, but then they are not supporting you. There are others, you know, you don't need their support that much, but of course, they are enthusiastically working for you to try and get the change done. So once you are able to identify people into these categories, you can have strategies to influence them. That's why we call it influencer matrix. Influence them to become the, or to embark on the change that you need to happen. So the fourth one is middle management. Of course,
hello,
middle management.
Sir.
Yeah.
Yeah, please. I would like to know which method is used in categorizing the staff of the company.
Which method? Oh, okay. Yeah. So what we're saying here is that there's no hard and fast method here that will say, do this, do that. No. You need to look at the individual employee. You know, like let's say you have somebody who comes to work late, for example. Now, you probably need that person. Let's say you have an IT person who is supposed to, you know, switch on systems and get things moving. And the person always comes late. You know, the person doesn't seem to, you know. So as an individual, you need to look at that person and see where to put that person. So is the role the individual plays, the abilities, the skills, and even the attitudes and the behaviors of that person. So it's an individual, person by person. You look at them and you can categorize them. There are no steps to categorize the employees. You as a change person, you need to be able to play those dynamics. You know? And then it's a whole process of trying to convince people or get people on board to agree with your change agenda. We all know that the moment most people don't agree with you, there's very little you can do. You know, I give an example of the clocking in system. You know, they can decide to go with what you are saying, but then they are really not convinced, or they are really not they have not bought into the idea at all. You see, if you say come to work at 8 o'clock, now that's just a command. That's why I would say dialogue with employees, but don't talk to them. You see, if you dialogue with them, to say that,
sir,
yes.
Please, I'm called Kofi Busanani.
Uh-huh.
Assuming such a person is the most important, technical man over there, and he always comes to work late, what are you going to do to such a person?
Yeah, so this is where your management skills should come in. What are you going to do to such a person? Now, maybe, first of all, and that's why we looked at building the capable champions. You can, as a change agent or a manager, try to see how you can convert that person. You know, first of all, try to be empathetic or try to empathize with the employees. And that's why we started by saying, trust people. You know, if I go back a few steps when we looked at where is it? The other one that we said, we said trust others a bit more, control them less. So what we're saying, so you need him, but he's always coming to work late. So it's sit down with the person and dialogue.
And know his problem.
Yeah, to know his problem. Probably, maybe he has transport issues or his children have to go to school. You know, there might be something. You know, if you exhaust all those things, and then that's where you now have to bring in force. You see, because if you just start by giving commands, normally commands are not sustainable. The person will come to work 2 or 3 days and then fall back to his previous way of doing things. So you need to understand the person, dialogue with the person. In fact, if you empathize with the person, if the person says, "Oh, I have issues with transport," you know, and say, "Oh, is it that maybe you don't have enough money to be coming to work or something, or you are driving a car, but you sometimes run out of fuel. You try to find ways. You can even say, okay, can we give you a soft loan or something? You know, try to be a bit, that's where the empathy comes in. So, yeah, so when the employee sees that you have their welfare at heart, you see, sometimes they themselves will even come to work, you know, without you, you know, because what they know that when they have issues, you will address or you help address them. You know, so that's yeah. Yeah, so that's where your management skills come in, you know. And you now have to decide how you are going to manage issues like that. Now, there are some organizations, you know, people, you know, obey all the rules. They do everything. You know, sometimes I give an example of the mall, for example. When you go to the mall, you see people mopping the toilets and the floors all the time. You know, you go to the ministries, and it's an entirely different story. Meanwhile, they're the same Ghanaians, and you'd be surprised the people, the cleaners at the ministry are paid more than those you see working at the malls. But how come? How come that they are on the job, you know, all the time cleaning the place, and whilst others who are even paid more are not? You know, so this is a management issue that, you know, and of course culture also comes in. So these are the dynamics that we are talking about. So, and you can always, you know, realize what the dynamics are within that organization that makes people give out all their best to work. Whereas in other organizations, you know, that pessimism is there. You see, if we, like I was just giving the example of the manager buying the car. You know, if I put in all my best at the end of the year, I have no reward, but I see that the boss is always traveling, you know, in the first class and going to sleep in high class hotels. Now that alone, you know, just demoralizes you. You know, so these are things that, in fact, most of these change things we are talking about, it has to do with management. You know, you need to be able to manage your employees. So the middle management, I think we've talked about this already. They are the ones who are the link between the top and the operational staff, and they are the ones who can either make or break your change agenda, because middle management can decide to sabotage you entirely. And sometimes when there's power play, when somebody is looking for you to go so that he will take over your position, you know, he can go and spoil you to the workers and other things. Sometimes agitations in workplaces, for example, when you delve deep, you realize that maybe some people are just pushing workers to go on strike and say they want a person to be changed. You know, somebody has interest, and so he's pushing those things. But if you know, you really involve middle management in everything that you do, you know, they all are on the same boat with you, then things are going to be much, much easier for them. So practices for increasing mid-manager involvement are also there. You know, invest in their skills training, you know, rewards. Then there's something called the plateaued middle manager. There's somebody who is not at the top, but he's plateaued, maybe he's at his 50s, late 50s, getting to retirement. Now, such a person, he still has skills, you know, he has that can help you. He's not aspiring to any position anymore. So it's possible that he might not be putting in his best. You know, because he just wants the years to the 2-3 years left to run, and then he'll go on retirement. Now, they will call those people the plateaued middle managers. He doesn't have any promotion to seek anymore. So they are mostly likely the people who just now can just resign to some routine things. But they have spent a whole lot of number of years in the organization, so probably they have a whole lot of knowledge and skills. So you don't need to ignore them. You have to, you know, keep them active by, you know, bringing out strategies that will help them engaged in a whole lot of things. You know. So formulating strategies and so on and so on, they are the ones who you need to involve all the time. Enable them to constructively challenge senior leaders, that's fine. They can, constructive criticism is always the best, you know, for any leader. You know, if we're not talking of people who are just trying to be mischievous or people who want your downfall, but people who actually want your organization to succeed and you, the leader, to succeed, sometimes can come with constructive criticisms. And sometimes they are the ones leaders also hate, because they will just tell you right in the face that, you know, leader, what you are doing is not right. And most leaders and managers don't want that. You know, they want the hypocrites who will come and praise you. They are not contributing anything to your improvement. So enable that climate of constructive criticism. You know, so people can bring out ideas. We'll talk about innovation or innovative management shortly. So the fifth one, systems thinking. So see the organization as a system or a network of interdependent components. So they are not autonomous things in the the various departments or the various sections. I was just giving an example of how sometimes technical people can go and explain a product, you know, to somebody, and then they will ask how much does it cost, and they'll say that one they don't know. So you have to go and contact the salespeople. Or you call an organization, maybe even a university here, somebody can call the reception and ask how much you charge how much is your school fees? And the receptionist does not know. You know, that is not so. When we talk of systems thinking, we need to see that every department is connected. So we don't treat them as separate divisions. You know, so whatever you're doing in one division affects the entire system. So, and all directed at your organizational goal. So the systems thinking here, you know, you need to always look at things holistically. So you don't look at the individual parts, but holistically. If sales are declining, you know, you don't blame just the salespersons. Probably the product quality has reduced, and so that has to do with production. Maybe the quality people were not on top of their job, and so the quality has reduced, and so on. And so if you are not engaged in systems thinking, that's the approach you take. Sales are declining, so you attack the salespeople. They are not doing their work well. And then, you know, you leave others. But whatever one person is doing affects the entire system. And so you need to understand that whole system. And so if you are going to implement any change, even in one division, you know, you want to move somebody from one division to the other and so on and so on, you have to look at the entire system as a whole and not treat, you know, departments as separate. And that's what we call systems thinking. So most of these progressive organizations, they don't work in silos, you know. So where in silos means you are separate. You go to this department, it's an entirely different, you know, establishment with their own rules, their own whatever it is. Then you go to another, as if it's another organization altogether. No, that shouldn't be the case. It should all work as one system. Because and the example people often use is just like any system, like the car that you are driving. You know, that's a whole system. If you ignore the brakes, it means there's one day that you cannot drive the car, or your fuel tank is leaking and you don't pay attention to it. No, it's going to affect the entire system. And so it's the same with organizations. Organizations are systems. So you should only look at them holistically. No. System behavior results from the effects of reinforcing and balancing processes. So you always need to have that balance in mind. No. So system thinking can enhance an organization's ability to experiment and learn new ways of doing things, because you are thinking holistically. You are not just thinking and there are some practices here, you know. Now there's something called the ripple effects, you know, what I was just talking about. You do something in one, but those of you who work with software probably have experienced this. You know, you have developed your software that is running, and then there's some small component that is giving you issue. Then you go to fix that, and before you realize, because of that small fix, the entire software, you know, begins to fail, you know, because it's everything is maybe running on a single database. You know, so you go and make an error on the database, and then one interface is not working, another is not, even though you are trying to fix a simple thing. And so ripple effects is the things that you can do at one site, and it will have an effect on the entire organization. So you need to always anticipate this before you bring in any changes. You know, think that, anticipate that. You know, you are likely to have, you know, somebody can say collateral damage, you know, whenever you are introducing changes. It says small changes can produce big results. And so you need to, optimal levers is just things that can trigger, you know, that trigger all these big changes that we're talking about. There are some changes you can make that will not be too significant for the entire organization. There are others that can be critical. And so we need to look at that. Feedback loops, you know, multiple feedback is critical in when it comes to communication. We'll look at communication shortly. You know, feedback is the more or less confirming your communication. So if I send out a message, unless I get feedback, I can't tell whether the message was interpreted the right way or not. Sometimes you can say something and people will interpret it in different ways. You know, so you need to know how the feedback works or identify how you can get feedback from all what you do. Align change initiatives. We've already talked about alignment. You know, make sure things are aligned, you know, especially with your vision. You know, seek to change associates' mental models. Okay. So mental models are just how we think of things. You know, so every individual has a mental model in the sense that there are some things you don't see physically, but you have a mental structure or a mental idea of how it looks like or how it works. Now, if I start describing something that you've never seen before, you create a mental model of it and try to understand what I'm saying. You know, so those are things. So in organizations, people have mental models. You know, so those mental models, as much as possible, should be aligned with your goal. So when I'm going to work, you know, if you ask me, why are you going to work? You know, are you going to earn your daily bread? You know, or you are going to make an impact on something. Now, there are some people, if it's left to just money alone, they probably will not be working, you know, because they have other things. You know. So these are things that as much as possible, you would want that if you ask your employees, why are you going to work? They will say that they are going to achieve this vision because you have outlined a vision. You know, I'm going to achieve this vision. I'm not going there because of the money, you know, but I want to contribute to the achievement of this vision. And so these are what we call mental models. People have all these type of mental models. You can align them. Vigorous dialogue. Okay, we've already talked of dialogue with employees. Maintain openness. So, and avoid entropy. We'll talk of entropy in the last presentation. What we call cultural entropy. You know what this is. Okay. Yeah, all right. So, the safe one, communication, we've talked of this already. Now you realize that most of these models, there's a considerable overlap in most of them. You know, so in this case, you come across things that by almost all the things that we're looking at, there's always communication.
Hello team, it looks like dog is awful, so we'll have to wait. His network is off now.
Yeah, I lost connectivity. Hello. Is it back?
Yes.
Yeah, I lost connectivity along the line. Okay. Yeah. Who is there? I lost connectivity now. I'm not the host, so I have to get.
It's okay. You've been assigned now.
Okay. Yeah, so that I can share the screen. All right. So. Okay. Good. Right. For some reason, I don't know what happened. I think it's just the internet acting up. Okay. Yeah. So. We already talked of the grapevine culture the last time. Try to avoid grapevine culture. Grapevine for culture festers in so many organizations. You know, you go to work and there is just no communication. You don't even know what is happening. Maybe the month has ended and salaries have not come. And then all you are, oh, I hear, they say there is no money, or I hear they have paid this before.